Well, those of you that did were able to see the Facing the Darkness movie this week. Those of you who haven't, and I hope will, tremendous story of course, the spread of Ebola in Western Africa, especially Liberia, and the hospital there, Elwa Hospital, that struggled to treat those who were dying, and the workers. And of course, then the story of how one of those workers becomes ill, two of them become ill. And can we get the slide up for that? Not there we go, good, thank you. Dr. Kent Brantley, and a nurse as well. And the tremendous fear that you're fighting something you cannot see, don't know how it gets past all the safety measures and dresses they use and all of that, and it's gaining. What are we going to do? And so on. And how these people in the, and they are real on this film. I mean, some of them talk about the kind of fear that they experienced, and yet knowing that this is where God called them and this is what God wants them to do. How can they have that kind of peace, commitment, courage in the face of that? One of my comments to my wife after we saw it is, you know, it would have been a little helpful for them, I'm sure, if they could have actually been, you know, rescuing it, seeing a few people survive it. But basically, they're tending to and making as comfortable as possible those that are dying and trying to prevent others from being infected. Well, today, as we study the armor, we come to the sandals or the shoes of the peace, gospel of peace. So open your Bibles to Ephesians 6. We've been talking about truth. We've been talking about the righteousness, breastplate of righteousness. And today we get to come to verse 15. I'm going to start reading the beginning of the sentence, verse 14. Stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. So, again, can I get the right slide up there? They're going to work on that. All right. In order to have spiritual victory, and that's what this is all about, we are commanded to be strong in the Lord, to be strong Christians, to have victory in spiritual warfare. And all of us have enemies, spiritual enemies. That is in the context we've been studying these Sundays. And now, in order for us to have spiritual victory, we must remain focused on our security in Christ. We must remain focused on the security we have in Jesus Christ. First of all, soldiers of Jesus Christ should be spreading the gospel of peace. This is talking about, this armor represents the gospel of peace. Satan and his forces are doing the very best to spread fear and death in this world. Now, we can look to places like ISIS and Iraq and Syria, and it doesn't take much at all to realize how much death Satan is bringing on purpose. We see brothers and sisters in Christ martyred across the world and so on. And right in our own country, we're slowly moving toward more of a culture of death. And, you know, stopping life before it begins and at the end and so on. Satan is doing his best. Don't need to say very much about that. Only the gospel of Jesus Christ can bring true peace. Now we, the soldiers of Jesus Christ, should be overcoming Satan's efforts with the gospel of Jesus Christ, because he is the only one who can bring peace both with God and with other people. Now, yes, we have all kinds of negotiators out there trying to negotiate peace, and politicians and all of that. And we hopefully see our military as a deterrent for the goal of peace. But there will never be world peace until Jesus Christ comes back and brings it. And the only peace that we can have is because of him. And we need to be soldiers carrying that message. We need to be overcoming Satan's efforts. We as soldiers of Jesus Christ are commissioned to take the offer of peace to the whole world. Praise God that many people, even in difficult places like the Middle East, today are turning their back on what they grew up with and all those beliefs, and finding Jesus Christ as the only peace between them and God that they will stand before in for eternity or in, at the end of their life. And the decision about where they'll spend eternity is based on their response to that. This involves, of course, as the Great Commission talked about, Jerusalem, Samaria, the world. Jerusalem. How are we doing with our Jerusalem? That's right here. That's Omaha. That's the people you and I touch and have relationships with and have some sort of ability to communicate with. That's our Jerusalem. And we need to get serious about being the kind of soldiers of Jesus Christ who are carrying that message, not holding it up, not containing it, not hiding it under a bushel, but letting our light shine and sharing it with them. Again, I encourage you, we have opportunities now. This leading up to the Easter season, we have movies like The Case of Christ. We have the breakfast early Saturday, Friday morning, Good Friday. Steve Green will be giving the gospel in his testimony. We have the Easter season when we can, you know, start with some questions, okay? Ask your friends and coworkers and people in the neighborhood, people at school, what is Easter about? What does Easter mean to you? Let them share. Give you an idea what they understand. Then share with them what Easter really means to you and how Jesus Christ has changed your life. The most victorious Christian, that's what we're studying in this passage, victory. The most victorious Christian is a witnessing Christian, someone who's sharing their faith. So we have to ask ourselves, how seriously do we take our need to be a witness for Jesus Christ? You know, we're excited as a church. We're moving to a new building and as a tool, as we've talked about, for the spread of the gospel and ministering to people. But a building doesn't do that automatically. You know, this building or any other building we might be in doesn't invite people. It doesn't share the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's just a tool. We have to do that. And as John talked about so well this morning, radical discipleship. We need to get to the point we're willing to obey and say, okay, I'm a soldier of Jesus Christ, and this is the message I carry, and this is the message I need to spread. We are going to have to be friendly. We're going to have to be inviting to people. We're going to have to go out of our way to talk to them and welcome them, make them feel welcome and all of that, and invite them. We're going to have to care enough for people around us and realize and remind ourselves that our friends and neighbors and co-workers and so on could end up in hell unless I share the gospel of Jesus Christ with them and the Holy Spirit convicts them and they put their faith in Jesus Christ. Remember, you say, well, I'm too afraid to do that. I don't know what they would say. I don't know what would happen. Courage is not the absence of fear. Courage is doing the right thing in the presence of fear. Even though we're afraid, even though those workers in Liberia were very afraid of Ebola, something that they were not able to stop or see or contain, they still had the courage to minister to these people who were dying and needed their help. That's courage. Let's ask God to set our hearts on fire, to reach lost people who are on the way to hell. That's what a strong Christian would do. Then we can have the beautiful feet of those who share the gospel. Romans 10:15 quotes Isaiah, really. And Paul says, how shall they preach unless they're sent? It is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace, who bring glad tidings of good things. Well, certainly, the readers, I think, of Ephesians, those churches in Ephesus and the area there reading this letter, would have thought that as a soldier, part of that armor was to share the good news, the gospel, the commission that God had given them. But there's a deeper meaning or a second meaning, and probably in this context, Paul is really talking about the armor giving us stability. God's soldiers of Jesus Christ should use the peace God gives them for stability in spiritual battle. How does that work? Well, first of all, why did he choose the sandals, the shoes we would call them, the sandals that the Roman soldiers wore? Roman soldiers wore sandals which provided firm footing in combat. Now, there's a couple words here that we don't use a lot in our English language. Verse 15, having shod your feet. Let's stop right there. Shod your feet. What is that? Shod means having bound under. It would be for us to lace up our work boots or running shoes or whatever. I grew up on a farm. It gets muddy. And if your boots aren't securely attached to your foot, you get in some mud that just sucks in your foot, you're going to lose your boot. I've done that. I know. So that's no fun. So you want your boot to be securely on. If you're running, you don't want to lose your shoe and have to stop and go back and pick it up. You securely lace it. A soldier, a Roman soldier, they weren't just on the pavement or on the grass. I mean, they had to go out and fight in muddy conditions. The enemy would have tried to draw them into those conditions. And they had to have firm footing. All right? So, 1 Peter 3:15 says, "But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts. Always be ready to give a defense to everyone who asks you a reason for the hope that is in you with meekness and fear." That speaks to the next word. Shod your feet with the preparation. Preparation. The Greek word there means establishment or firm foundation. Has the idea of making ready. In that case, preparing our minds for battle. It signifies the state of being ready or prepared for use or for action. You and I ought to have these pieces of armor on all the time, these first three at least, and we ought to have our feet shod, firmly attached to, being prepared, a firm foundation, so that we are stable, do not slip. You know, here's a little picture of maybe what the Roman sandals were like. They were bound by pieces of leather, both over the instep and around the ankle. Not just one little strap that you might see today. No, they were firmly on this foot of this soldier. It couldn't come off. And the soles were thickly studded with nails. We call it hobnailed, so that they had extra traction on slippery ground. This would give the soldier firm footing in battle. Imagine the disaster, the deadly consequences, really, of slipping and falling down in front of the enemy soldier, in front of your enemy. What does this mean for us? Believers can have stability in spiritual battle only if they focus on the peace they have as a result of their faith in Jesus Christ. If we are to withstand in the battle all of the attacks we have from a spiritual enemy, we need sure footing. We need a solid foundation. That comes from the peace, the gospel of peace, as this verse talks about. First of all, it includes the footing or the relationship we have with God, that we have peace with God. He is not our enemy. We do not have to, as Romans 5 tells us, we don't have to face condemnation. I don't have to fear that if my last breath were this afternoon, I would stand in front of God as a righteous judge who would send me to hell and condemn me for my sin and rebellion against Him. Because I have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ has done. Romans 5:1, therefore, having been justified, made righteous by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. It's only through our faith in Jesus Christ alone that we have peace with God. We have been reconciled. In this book, Ephesians 2:17, and He came and preached peace to you who were afar off and to those who were near. Peace means that which has been bound together. Or another way to think about it is harmony, harmonious. Now, we appreciate the worship team coming up here and leading us in worship. And they sing in beautiful harmony. If they were constantly off pitch, it wouldn't sound like harmony to our ears. It would sound like they're fighting each other, right? Or if the instruments were off pitch or something was out of tune, it wouldn't be harmonious. It wouldn't sound very peaceful. That's the idea here. We have harmony with God, our Creator. We have peace. We don't have to fear Him. Believers ought to communicate to one another in peace and harmony, not arguing, dissension, all of that. The word gospel, of course, means good news. And actually, the word gospel, euangelion, is kind of unique in its use in the New Testament. The word is kind of rare in classical Greek. They didn't use it very much, and there's a reason for it. There's a reason for it. It was used seldomly because it referred to news that was so good, it was too good to be true. Now, sometimes you remind yourself or tell your children or whatever, if someone offers you something that sounds too good to be true, it probably is. Well, in this case, the gospel, the offer that if you put your faith in Jesus Christ, who died on the cross to pay the penalty for your sin, you can have the gift of eternal life, you can be at peace with God, you're totally reconciled with Him. That sounds too good to be true, but it is true. And that's why the gospel, that word, is used in the New Testament with that special sense. God sent His Son, the Lord Jesus, to make peace by the blood of His cross. Isn't it great timing that today we get to celebrate communion and remind ourselves of how that reconciliation was paid for, the tremendous cost, and Jesus voluntarily giving His life to reconcile us. Because of the peace we have with God, we do not need to fear the attack of our spiritual enemies or how they use other men against us. I mean, we can be secure in our relationship. Now, if we are not secure in our relationship with God, if we have all those doubts and wonders and whatever, then we are not going to have the firm foundation to say no to Satan and his demonic forces when they try to accuse us and they try to change our mind, they try to get us off track, they try to knock us over. You've probably been in some situations, I don't know, with a boss or a relative or a kind of a friend where your relationship is so tenuous. It's like you're always walking on eggshells. I mean, you were afraid to do anything for fear of offending them and for fear of them just saying, okay, that's it, forget it, I don't want to talk to you anymore. We cannot have that relationship with God, or we cannot be strong Christians and victorious. He wants us to have a firm foundation. He wants us to know what our relationship is with Him so that we have no doubt. This is why, to me, I take very seriously the attempt today on the part of some theologies to undermine the assurance of our eternal life. And they either say you can lose it if you don't live well enough, or if you don't live a certain lifestyle, you prove you never were saved, you were just deceived. This is serious. This undermines the foundation. This undermines this gospel of peace that you and I are to stand on, the firm foundation we need. And I'm afraid Satan just loves the effects of that. Because if you and I walk around on eggshells, not knowing for sure what the situation is between me and God and how it's going to end up in the last, you know, at the end of our life, then we don't have that firm footing that we need. You cannot share a solution, the gospel, a way to heaven, with someone else if you're not sure it applies to you first. You just can't share something you haven't experienced yourself. I've went to Russia and taught in the Bible college there, and Vitaly came in. His father was a pastor, but you know, the theology was taught you can lose your salvation. And Vitaly had he was now 18. He had tried hard to live the Christian life as he thought he should, and he kept failing. And Vitaly said, "You know, there's no way I can make it to heaven. I can't be good enough to stay saved." And yet he came to Bible college and said, "I don't want to work for Satan. I want to work for God. Maybe," this is his words, "maybe even though I can't make it to heaven because I can't stay living good enough, maybe I can help point someone else so maybe they can make it to heaven." Oh, what a tragedy. And what a joy to, as teacher after teacher, expounds God's word. And Vitaly here is something very different than that. And sees his classmates, as he says in his words, "One by one the light come on, sparkling as they gain assurance of their salvation according to the promises of the Word of God." And finally, he himself gains that. And his ministry today is a result of that. This included peace with other believers. We've already mentioned that. Ephesians 2:14-15. "For he himself is our peace, who has made both one and has broken down the middle wall of separation, having abolished in his flesh the enmity, that is, the law of commandments contained in ordinances, so as to create in himself one new man with the two, thus making peace, Paul labored in Ephesians to prove that Jews and Gentiles putting their faith in Christ are brothers and sisters in Christ, no difference in their standing with God. And if Jews and Gentiles could bridge that gap, you and I can bridge a gap with any other believer. Well, keeping our focus upon the foundation we have in Christ will help us stay on our feet when others are getting knocked down in the spiritual battle. And that is the goal of having these sandals, this gospel of peace, as our footing, as our foundation. Satan's forces try to use varying strategies to knock us off our feet and get us down. Some, we've experienced this. Circumstances. Oh, things are took a turn for the worse, and we're, you know, panicked. Situations, friends, relationships changing, finances, lose your job, setback, whatever, career, you know, dashed hopes, things that don't go the way we thought they would. Satan's goal is to keep you and me defeated. He wants to prevent us from experiencing God's purpose, God's provision, forward movement, growth in our life, experiential sanctification we've been talking about, and the blessing that God wants in our life. Satan wants to prevent all of that. He can't take you out of heaven. You've got eternal life guaranteed by the promises of God, but he can try to hinder your spiritual growth and your victory. Because he cannot keep us out of heaven, he wants us to experience hell on earth as much as he can. Satan does not want us to live based upon God's peace. He does not want us to live based upon God's peace. When you and I stop using this part of the armor, when we stop allowing God's peace to umpire our life, then we do not sleep well anymore. We can't think as clearly as we used to. We don't function as well. We say things we regret. We do things we know we shouldn't. On down the list, if you and I do not focus on our relationship with Jesus Christ and how important that is as our foundation, we do not live a victorious Christian life. Peace includes completeness, wholeness, and an inner resting of the soul that does not fluctuate based on outside influences. That's very, very important. Because we're focused on the body. We're focused on the outside, the circumstances. We're focused on our feelings. We're focused on our logic, all those kinds of things. And the peace that Jesus Christ gives us is in our spirit. Remember, we talked last time about how our spirit needs to dictate, needs to umpire, needs to make all the decisions. An umpire in a baseball game, of course, makes the calls, says this is the way it is, and everybody accepts it. You and I need to allow God's truth, God's promises in his word, in our spirit, the new man that he put in us, to umpire, to make the calls, to make the decisions, to inform our feelings. No, sorry, I know you feel that way, but that's not true. And we need to follow that. The Greek word for peace is equivalent to the Hebrew word shalom. That's their word for peace. They would use it to bless one another as they greet one another. If you are at peace, you are stable, calm, orderly, at rest within yourself. Ask yourself honestly, how much of your life is at rest, at peace, calm? If you are not at peace, you're experiencing inner chaos, anxiety, worry. Some artists have tried to paint pictures of peace. In fact, there have been some competitions. Don't have time, but that, you know, this is kind of a picture of what most of us think about as peace, right? Very peaceful situation, not a wave on that water, so peaceful you can see the reflection of everything. That's the kind of peace you and I think about and want most of the time. But there's peace even within the storm. Here's another artist's conception of peace. Now, you can see there's a storm here. It's pouring rain. The rain's washing down on the rocks. You can see lightning out here and all kinds of the effects of the wind. But I don't know if you can see it on this screen. I'll blow it up in a bit. Right down here is a little bird sitting in a cleft in the rock at total peace. Here it's blown up a little bit. You can see where the artist has this little bird right here. That's the kind of pictures that win the competitions. Because this is a different kind of piece, isn't it? It's not affected by the circumstances. It's a peace that resonates from within, despite what's going on all around. Peace doesn't refer to an inner calm when all around you is calm. When you're surrounded by tranquility, you're supposed to be calm. That's expectable. When you experience godly peace, you are at rest, even when everything else is all wrong. Here's another picture. How the waves can break against the lighthouse out there on this little island. And here's a picture you can see of a man standing right here in the open doorway, secure, knowing the lighthouse, as it was designed, will stand against the waves. Peace in the midst of great disruption, you could say. When you and I remain calm, because of the peace that God, it is so supernatural that those watching it are totally amazed. And that's what God says. Philippians 4, 6 through 7. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Be anxious, worry, you know, all that inner turmoil for nothing. Don't do that. Let your request be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. No matter how much turmoil is in your life and the circumstances and at work, at school, and relationships, all of that, you can have the peace of God because your foundation, your relationship with Him is totally secure, and He wants us to be peaceful. That is one instance when we can share about Jesus Christ in your life. You know, I've said often, God doesn't exempt believers from a lot of the trials in this life. We lose loved ones, and we get cancer, and we lose jobs, and financial setbacks, and all of that stuff, and part of it is for our own growth. God wants us to learn to depend upon Him more and more. But part of it is as a lighthouse. I mean, when people, when the world watches somebody in the cancer ward, in the funeral home, other places, when the finances go set back, when the market goes down, whatever, that's when they really watch us to see if this Jesus Christ we talk about really makes a difference. Is this really real? And if you and I can have the peace of God in these situations that God asks us to have, we are a light shining in a dark world. And then we can be witness, not to our own strength. We're not doing this by our strength. It's because of Jesus Christ, and He's in our life, and how His relationship with us, that we can have peace. We need to have more of this kind of spiritual victory. We need not to have to respond to Satan's attempts to scare us and defeat us. We can have spiritual victory that God wants to give us. The peace of God guards our hearts and our minds. We are commanded to allow the peace of God to umpire our hearts. Colossians 3:15, let the peace of God rule. That word rule there is like the umpire we talked about. Let the peace of God rule in your hearts, or umpire, or make the calls, make the decisions, tell you how to feel, tell you how to act, tell you how to think, to which also you were called in one body, and be thankful. When we make decisions, we need to make them according to the truth of God's word, which will give us peace amongst whatever turmoil we're facing. Jesus was a very good example of this. The night before His crucifixion, we have recorded in the book of John lots of things He said to His disciples leading up to that evening. And some of those verses are this. John 14, 27, Jesus said, "Peace I leave with you." Jesus knows He's leaving. He's going to be crucified. "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you." Jesus had peace facing the cruelest death man could dream up. having God the Father lay the sins, your sins, my sins, the sin of the whole world, upon him so he could pay. He has peace. He says, I give it to you, disciples, not as the world gives. That's fleeting. That's temporary. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. Use my peace. If Jesus could have peace facing crucifixion on the cross and give his disciples blessing and tell them to be peaceful, then you and I, and by the way, we see brothers and sisters in Christ who face martyrdom too, very peacefully, then you and I ought to allow God's peace to conquer our fears about facing trials in our life, about sharing the gospel, all those kinds of things. I mean, we ought to be able to do that peacefully if these people could do so much more. The peace we receive from Jesus remains while the peace of this world is fleeting. John 16:33. These things I have spoken to you that in me you may have peace. In the world you have this tribulation. You will have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. You can have peace. I have overcome it. You know, sailors out on the sea in a submarine don't have to fear any storm. They just dive down and go under it, right? You and I need to go deep in our foundation with Jesus Christ. When the storm is there, we need to focus on our foundation. We can go through that storm. God will give us the strength and the peace to do it. Keeping your shoes of God's peace strapped on securely will help you, will help me, to access God's supernatural power for victory in spiritual warfare. Isaiah 26:3, you will keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on you because he trusts in you. If you and I, facing spiritual battle or whatever we face, if we will stay focused on God, if we will stay focused on Jesus Christ, if we will stay focused on our relationship with him, we can have supernatural peace, is God's promise. Now, we've seen today that in order to have spiritual victory, we must remain focused on our security in Jesus Christ. You know, there are many, many biblical examples of this, but another great one is the three men in the fiery furnace, right? I mean, they refused to bow to an idol, and the king threatened them. He's so angry, he commands the furnace to be heated 7 times hotter than normal. The people, the Bible says, throwing them in died. You can see the artist's conception of that here. And yet, these three men, look at their response. Daniel 3:16-18. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego answered and said to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If this is the case, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from your hand, O king. He's able. That's true faith and prayer, isn't it? God, we ask you to deliver us. We know that you are able. Our faith is in you. But if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we do not serve your gods, nor will we worship the golden image which you have set up. No matter what happens to us, no matter if God chooses to save us, or if he lets us perish in the fire, we are at peace because we know we have done the right thing. We followed God. We worship him. And if God, as he did in these three men, if God changes our circumstances, we give him praise. If he does not change our circumstances, we know that he will give us the supernatural peace and strength to go through those circumstances in victory. There was a little boy sitting on a passenger plane, and this passenger plane entered a storm, and there was thunder and lightning, and the wind was buffeting, and lots of air currents, and the plane was going up and down, and I've been on a plane like that. I've heard people scream and so on. Passengers were panicked, but this little boy was just sitting there calmly as could be. He stuck out like a sore thumb. Everybody else was panicking. And some of the people sitting around him said to the little boy, little boy, how can you be so calm in this tremendous storm? Aren't you afraid? He said, no. He said, why not? He says, because my father is up there flying the plane. Ah, when you and I know who controls, who's at the controls, we can have peace, even in the middle of life's storms. Father, thank you for this piece of armor that you provide for us. Through the blood of Jesus Christ, you have given us, who put our faith in you, the relationship and the foundation we need to be secure. We need to stay focused on the important things, no matter what the circumstances, no matter what life throws us, no matter what Satan and his demonic forces try to do to discourage us and defeat us and knock us down. We need to obey your command to stand strong, to have as our firm foundation the assurance we have in the promises of your word, truth, the belt of truth. We stand in the righteousness of Jesus Christ that's been charged to our account, as we saw last Sunday as we talked about the breastplate of righteousness. And we need that supernatural power to give us peace in the midst of turmoil, so that we can glorify you. Help us to be serious about letting your peace rule in our hearts and affect our decisions. In Jesus' name, amen.